you can maybe still a bit clarify my doubts. What is the typical situation where we are interested in this compactification? I thought the usual situation, typical situation, X is compact, there is some G or S acting, but this sound of our logic, which is not compact. And then we compactify this S or G.
Okay. By X.
So this is in the paper X and not compact.
Yes. Sometimes we get just factors, even if X is compact. The compactification will be factored.
Okay, so because I was thinking
that in order to compactify your acting group, there are two possibilities. Look at your G, it's a dynamical system acting on itself from the left. And the second possibility, G acts on some compact space. Consider analogic symmetry. And automatically you get some compactification of your acting group, because analogic symmetry,
this is
the case. Compactification.
So this is the case where X is compact, but you compactify the group by taking this single acting symmetry.
But be careful, with this compactification, the compactation is maybe not embedded. For our setting, the compactifications are not necessarily embedded. So let's try. Continue our lectures. Shalom to everybody. I would like to first of all to recall something and maybe to continue on the same point. Yesterday we mentioned several results about topological groups. This result comes as applications of this theory I'm trying to explain. I mean, representations of topological groups on Banach spaces. Today, a little bit later, I will explain what is Telemann's theorem. The Telemann's theorem is a good introduction because it gives us an idea how can we modify the construction of Telemann and try to reach more interesting cases. First of all, about this list of results. After my conversation with Michal yesterday, I decided to add two more questions and a remark, a result by Ferry and Galindo. I already mentioned that the group H plus 01 is not reflexively compatible, and even you have no possibility to even any representation should be trivial. Okay? It's a conclusion, every semi-topological compactification is trivial. Trivial means just one point. But the question, one day question was open, posed the following question: what if our group is abelian? H plus is very far from the abelian, of course. And this was a natural question. Is it true that every abelian topological group is reflexively represented? And Ferry and Galindo answered this question negatively, very interesting way. If you take additive group of Banach space C0 as a Polish topological group, it turns out that it is not reflexively represented. It's very interesting. paper, and it, however, this paper.
So, this is some kind of product of logic.
What?
It's a norm.
Yes, of course.
It's a norm.
C0 is a topological group with respect to the additive group. It's a norm topology. impression was this paper I sent, it left one of more questions left. What if, in this question by the way, in this result, if you take C0, you still can construct a reflexive representation which is injective. So, just if you take vector homology of C0, with respect to vector homology, C0 is reflexively representative. So, you have some continuous injection into the isometric group of some reflexive planar space. And the question is now, if it is true always, so the question 4-6, is it true that for every abelian topological group there exists a continuous injective representation where V is reflexive? So this question is open. I wanted to show that there are still many other questions. One of them, my favorite questions, and also question of Ferry Galim, and also myself. Another question, is it true that C0 is Hausdorff representative? It is also open, it's my question, and I already mentioned that it is open, this part in our chain of inclusions, to distinguish the part of Asplund and reflex. And one of the chances, one of the possibilities to distinguish, to answer this question, to have some contribution sound, one of the most maybe natural candidate, for me at least, is C0. So even my conjecture is that C0 is not Asplund representative. It is quite a delicate question because C0 as a Banach space is Asplund, but we are speaking about representation in the isometric group of some Asplund space.
So why reflexive representability doesn't imply Asplund representability?
Yes, but that's the problem. C0 is not reflexive representability.
It's not? Okay.
Yeah. It is not reflexive. So there is, still we have this question open. So it's a very, very natural question. Okay, now
concerning the second question, you said that it's open whether every Banach space is Rosenthal, every group is Banach representable, right? So whether the Banach space is always Rosenthal, so it is unknown also for the case where the Banach space is from Telmann's theorem, like the right uniform continuity.
Every topological group is Banach representative.
Yes.
But we need more. We ask if Asplund representative.
And so those Banach spaces, those right uniform continuity on the group G, yes, they are they Rosenthal or?
No. As usual, they are very is very bad geometry. That writing from continuous functions on G, and so in this way there is no possibility to get some good examples, some good Banach spaces. You may take RUC G and try to understand when this Banach space is Asplund and so on.
Yes.
No.
Rosenthal, for example, because you said it's unknown whether every group which is Banach representable is Rosenthal representable. So.
Right. But for just a very simple example, if you take even discrete group, okay, say Z. What is LZ? It's just L infinity. So L infinity is not Rosenthal. So there is almost no chance to get good Banach spaces by constructions like C of X, which is compact, or RUC. I think there are some general results which show that these kinds of two general constructions, you have something very, very general position, not reflexive as Asplund or even. But of course, your question is natural, but my answer, aside to my knowledge, that we have almost no chance directly get something. That is why we need something smart, something more. That is why we. I try to understand what happens where you have topological proof, and the natural idea now is try to find some faithful action of your topological group or some good dynamical system. So such action, such resulting dynamical system is good, is nice, which gives you a chance to construct good boundary spaces, but not directly, not by C of K, not functionally, but again, using some smart results and among others, Davis Figel, Joseph Belchinsky, factorization. There are some tools I need to explain. That is why I maybe need to skip some technical parts. But again, first of all, elementary observations. We mentioned something about.
But it's possible that some other case, some other C of K, constructed case scattered would be a good asking space.
It's a good, good question. So if K is scattered, we mentioned that CK is asking if and only if K is scattered. So this also gives some sufficient conditions. For example, if you take S infinity, okay, as say S infinity, not a symmetry group, and as a Polish group, you have action on one point from quantification. The natural numbers and of course this K is a scatter and in this way you can embed your symmetry group, Polish symmetry group, into isometric group of the Banach space C of K. The K is a one-point quantification. But okay, it's good news. Why? Because here CK, now we know by this theorem, is asymptotic. So S infinity is asymptotic representable. Very good. But bad news here is that we can do it much better. In fact, S ASO S infinity can be represented in Hilbert spaces. I mean, if you take coordinate-wise action, okay, on L2, this coordinate-wise most natural maybe is what Tipkins can do now. This action will be induce embedding, disembedding. So, of course, it's much stronger. And again, this theorem in this case is good. It gives something. Maybe in some cases it can help. But at this moment, I don't know something good, some good results, which I cannot perform by my results or by something this way. But using this, but anyway, this good question. Why one of the results, maybe I'm trying to speak about this, is that sometimes it is this theorem can be useful for symbolic dynamic, like dynamical systems. I have some results. Below we will speak about this. So let me continue. So elementary observations is maybe too elementary, but we should start with something to understand the depth of this direction. So we know now that no chance to try representing topological groups, even very simple topological group in finite dimensional spaces. It was very expected. But what about Banach spaces? So we know several times we mentioned that the answer is yes. Now let's try now understand why. And even some hints we already have. But just we will use Gelfand representation of compact spaces, I mean representation by point mass, every point close to the point mass functional. Okay, what we need technically here, so I mentioned also yesterday two exercises that source getting topological groups. Anybody which is interested in topological groups knows that isometric groups with respect to point-wise topology is a good exam, one of the most important results is topological groups. Okay, this exercise and the next exercise, if you take some compact space, they consider a homeomorphic group with respect to a compact open topology. Again, everything is very standard, very well known. But I put here these exercises in order to, you know, to try to recall the tricks and what kind of technique we need there. And anyway, you have in my exercises file the full proofs in this case. Not hint, but full proofs, including even definitions. So what I want to mention in this moment, that we have a little bit more, not only for a group side, if you take even some subsemigroup of CY1, so some submonoid of this monoid, okay, with respect to the composition. Again, with respect to the compact open topology, the induced action will be continuous, and this semigroup will be topological. Okay? This is, again, very natural to expect. Moreover, we have some very remarkable minimality property. It is, again, it counts as a direct application of standard compactness arguments, that these topologies, compact open topology, have some minimality in this sense. If you have this topology, tau CO means compact open, is the smallest topology which guarantees the continuity of the evaluation action. Okay, so please keep this exercise and think about this exercise when we will need it in few minutes below. Okay, evaluator topologies we already mentioned about SOT and WOT, weak operator topology and strong operator topology. And let me recall again that with respect to a weak operator topology, theta of V is monoid, is always semi-topological. And if you take strong operator topology, you have you get a topological monoid. Again, these kind of exercises you have full solutions in exercise 5. So let me skip explanation, because explanations is just a straightforward checking definitions. And what is not trivial, and we already proved it, you know, during first lecture, that sometimes in good cases of Banach spaces, operator topology, what and salt are the same, but not on the theta V, it's impossible, just on the group, on the isometric group. For example, it happens for reflexive Banach spaces, and we will need several times maybe below. And is, as you remember, I hope so, that you remember that the main trick in the proof was fragmentability. I mentioned several times also yesterday, fragmentability helps and we define something by fragmentability and so on. And reflexivity was proved by the fact that every weakly compact subset is fragmented, weak, no. But if you take Banach spaces with P, CP, point continuity property, the same is true because every bounded subset here is fragmented with respect to weak topology and no. So it mimics the same, absolutely the same proof. That is why this result I mentioned for reflexive space can be extended to PCP. Now let me recall again some classical results from analysis, functional analysis by the new Glicksberg and even Eberlein and many other people. They dealt with the theta v. Maybe with other notation, but you know it's not important. It's a compact semi-topological semigroup for every reflexive V. In fact, it characterizes reflexive spaces because we have a very simple lemma, which means that if you take theta of V, then as the corresponding action of theta of V of such operators on the unit ball is transitive. Because if you take some F so theta of V of course acts not only from V star by the way, theta V op acts from the left on V star, but theta V acts from the small on V. What was V? Just unit ball in V. So if you take some vector here, V on the sphere, the unit sphere, then you have some huge object theta here, which acts on our V. And this lemma says that actually you get not only sphere, but on the ball.
And I must be confusing something, but I remember a theorem saying any Banach space can be renormed, so that the only isometries onto are plus minus identical.
No, isometries.
And here,
what is theta v?
Theta is contractive.
It's again good question. Okay. Theta v is the isometries is a very small part here. Theta v is all operators with norm not equal to 1. Okay, so it's no problem here. But again, it is good to think about because we understand that in contrast to isometries, theta v contains much more information. That's the conclusion for the remark. And so now the proof is very expected, quite easy because we can use rank 1 operators this way.
So theta v. Could you recall me the definition? Theta are contractive onto, or you don't assume onto?
On, see?
In the definition of theta V.
No.
It doesn't
not
have
on. Onto. No, not assume.
So really, any isomorphism?
Isometric group is just...
No, any operator, actually, if you multiply by some factor, is in theta V.
Yes, any linear operator is this point. But from isometries, we have the restriction. Okay, because it's an invertible element, this one. So, I think it is understood if you take this way our rank 1 operator, it will move, take something here, Z. You have a possibility to, you know, to find the corresponding rank 1 operator, which moves V to Z. Let's say just one line. Okay, the following are equivalent. So this observation helps us to understand the following criteria. V is reflexive if and only if the ball, unit ball or any other is weakly compact, and our theta V is compact. So the equivalence of those first and second is just classical, well-known fact. What the relation with the third condition? So from 2, from 3, because theta V can be think, we can think it as a part of B to B, by definition, okay? By definition of Gibbs topology, is a closed subset, and applying up to equal of theta, that's all. And the reverse direction, from 3, 2, we need corollary, this corollary, just 1 minute again. If you have, in this way, what you have, in fact, you have transitivity, algebraic transitivity, so corresponding orbit map will be on top, okay, from theta V on B. In this way, if theta V is compact, B is compact too in big topology. So this gives us very this nice characterization. Okay, now back to Telemann's construction. In fact, it's not a Telemann's construction, but we need it to prove.
I
just
one question. The previous lemma, why not in this lemma, but in the previous page? So the proof, I don't see from the proof, why do you need big topology on B? So,
what?
So if you take any finite rank, you can move.
Why it's continuous?
No, I mean, if you take any finite rank operator, you can find a finite rank which moves any vector to any vector. So this is really an algebraic statement? Or?
Yes, it's an algebraic statement.
But he wants continuity.
Yeah, okay, continuity is easy by definition. Continuity is easy by definitions of weak topologies. Okay, so let's back to a joint operation. So I mentioned that sometimes we sign S star, sometimes not, by some technical reasons, but maybe this lemma we need it again, or at least in order to understand the formulation. Okay, what we need in this lemma? When we are speaking about theta of V, even we can use this action. So we have two kinds of actions. Theta V acts on B, and the opposite one way. Acts on B star. So now if you think about these semigroups as a family of some translations, so theta V in some sense is you can think as a part of CBV. And theta V opposite semigroup as a part of continuous functions from B star to B star. Now we need to compare between these two topologies. And it turns out that in fact they are the same up to this translation from our semigroup to its adjoint. That's a very expected fact, but it is a key idea in some point in the group. So what we